I mean, well, Drake is alive, so that'll probably be the most obvious choice. You can already see the Miz being pushed in from Larson. That forces Jennings to catch the wave. Larson with a level advantage means that he, along with Inspired and the bot lane, can easily move up to setup for this. With both Infernal and Matt being taken off the board, we're looking at a cloud or an ocean. I think Rogue would much rather take the ocean. Just because I don't think they gain as much value from the cooldown reduction on the ultimates, considering most of them are actually pretty low anyway.
It's going to be Cloud though, and perhaps jumping onto Bandit here with limits on the chase. Bandit can stand beside the Inspired and back away. Even with the trickshot rush, it's not going to do too much. And I do think we're starting to see a little bit of what the tank K's weakness is. Which is, they're not an incredibly proactive team. You set it in pick and ban, they tend to rely on the enemy team to make mistakes.
I mean, it's also really hard for them to force things right now because of the comp that they've drawn for themselves. It's the Man of Mune and the Ura Mana that I always confuse the two on. He currently has the Man of Mune, and that's not a great item at this point in the game, right? Ezreal's only level 9, he's relatively weak, of course, while he's ahead of Hunt Summer. I don't think they want to force a fight right now when you have a lot of ages completed, and Inspired already has Warrior enchantment, so they prefer to play on the defensive for now. Things like the training force being completed is what we're looking for, but often what we will see is an early priority on the training force while the Tage just sits in your inventory, and then you upgrade that item later on the Ezreal, so you hit that item spike sooner. So probably because he's playing with the Victor, and he knows that an early Bramble Vest is coming from Sacre, he still believes he'll hit that training force around the same time as the core itemization from the other two, and then you'll be in a fine spot.
But you can see Trick spending time down around that bottom lane looking for a gank has really cost him his entire topside jungle and this turret. Sucker heads back all the way away, even went back to base. They give up the tower in the top lane, both get the first turret of the game. And now Trick is like, well, I've got no red buff, I've got no crux, I've got no razor beaks, may as well gank! Or look to see if he can find one. Inspired realizes that could be the case, and is just waiting around the river bend here. Doesn't even need it. Backs away. There's a 1,000 gold. Oh, 1,700 gold in that top lane now for Finn. And he's got 5 stacks on that cull. Just about to finish that. So Finn is in an incredible position right now.
It's funny because for anyone that was able to watch Game 1 as well as Game 2, you get to see the stark contrast of what happens when you invest in set versus when you don't. When he's forced to play in an isolated matchup, he doesn't gain the same priority that he normally would, and by going for the aftershock, you don't have the same trading power that you normally get from a Conqueror. So Finn is allowed to play so much more aggressively, but of course he's also got his jungler playing for his top side. Top lane is so influenced by jungle presence that you can see how it's so much benefited Finn and how strong he is. We saw how he carried yesterday on the Aatrox. He's now in a great position to be able to do that again today.
Rogue here able to spend offside even while they get the Rift Herald on top. They're 3,000 gold ahead. I have to admit, I'm a little disappointed in a few of these plays by SK. They set up vision around the bottom side, they don't really pressure hard enough to get the turret. It's defended just by Finn, who's strong enough to defend in a 1v3 band that came out around the end, but they give up the dragons, they give up the rift herds, they're really not taking anything for themselves. And as you said, it's hard for them right now, they'll be waiting for that first spike, but I wonder if they'll take the game into their hands at that point, or if they'll be too far behind.
Well, so the problem that SK has, is that usually, even if you're in losing matchups, you can move around the map in a way so that you trade.
Yeah.
Like, okay, fine. If we know we're going to lose our bot tower, we'll go topside and we'll trade for Rift Herald so we can get some of the plates back. If we know we're going to lose Drake, we'll trade for a Herald, right? So normally you can do that, but SK is often responding to the pressure being generated by Rogue rather than actually trying to generate pressure themselves. You can see Sakura is now left isolated in the top lane, no one's even moving yet.
Yeah, on this play, Rogue obviously giving credit for their positioning on the map as Trick perhaps looks for a fight. Rogue have played the lane assignment as well. Yeah. But they pressured with two men, they put a Rift Herald up in top, and SK lose both the top tower and the mid tower while not defending anywhere. Now Rogue are actually going to look to attach out Jennax in the bottom lane as well.
They're the ones making the play, they're the ones taking the game into their own hands.
And I wonder if Jennax is going to be able to survive here. It looks like with the Chaos Storm he will. Clears out the wave and Rogue just back away.
So Rogue doing what they often do in the first 20 minutes of the game, have very clean map movements, have very good control over the map state, and they manage their minion ways very well. They're very good at utilizing the priorities that they have, and we talked about it in draft. We said that this game is largely going to be about can Rogue get lost into a position where he can carry on a side lane. And you can already see from the goal difference, thank you very much Observers for highlighting the fact that the mid difference is pretty huge, right? About a 1,000 goal difference, and when we can switch back to the items, we can see how that's translating. Two items now done, for the Rise. You also have the boat treads completed as well. In the top lane, Finn working towards his death stance, nearly completed. Training Force, nowhere near done yet for Starkrave, not done yet for Crown Shot. So Rogue is already in a power position before FT Top has actually even been able to come online. When they get the Training Forces completed, maybe then they can look for a fight, but it seems like Rogue is going to get an opportunity before that and FT start off the break.
With the patient game.
Okay, force the Cloud Drake.
Rogue decided they're not in the position to go for it. They don't want to force the fight, they can just continue to gain advantages. A single Drake doesn't really cost them too much.
I think that this time SK were just first on the play in that situation, and I thought it was more dangerous for them, but a good use of the gravity field from Jack's zone, Rogue away, making it harder for them. Jack's that needs to be careful, the risk of a collapse is very real, but again, he's going to invest everything to help clear the way.
Aerosol coming out last, flashing forward for the room, Rivers and Death to Sonic Wave and inspired.
Three on the board for the Rogue Jungler now. And now with the wave clear dead and nothing that Jemex can really do, it makes it very easy for Rogue to invest resources into this bot tower and finally open up the map completely against SKD.
6,000 gold lead for Rogue coming up to that 20-minute mark. That was the first kill we've had in about 10 minutes or so. So perhaps we've entered that scaling portion of the game that we were promised in Pick and Ban. Slow and steady for Rogue, but that's why he doesn't pull these stacks there after it's 19 minutes.
Yep. And a 6-stack run of ages.
No one's going to kill us. We're at that point now, man.
Already?
Yeah. I mean, like, he's a more dark. Like, he's so strong.
So how much do you think SK would need to invest to kill us? How many players?
Probably three, at a minimum.
I assume two of those have to be damage dealers, so it could be like Shot and Trick.
Well, I mean, like, I think Trick still does damage. Yeah, I think you would be... I don't know. I'm just saying you need a lot of stuff to kill him.
I understand.
Because, like, when you look at his goals, he has the same as Finn in the top lane. He's level 13 already. And he's like 600 more gold than Jax. Like, that's like half an item, right? It's crazy how further ahead he is from his opposition. And the jungler's experience, like the whole top side of Rogue is so strong. Like, we did see Hansama die in a 1 versus 2 in the bot lane. But again, it's all about resource investment, and Rogue have invested their jungle attention to mid and top, and it has paid off extremely well for them. And now SK is in the slump where I don't think they really outscale. Again, the only thing I talked about where they have an opportunity is challenging for Rogue to engage. But you don't necessarily need to engage if you just play the map very well. And yet you also are in a better position to play the 1-4, where you can actually invest your players into the Baron, where you send the Ryze to the bot side of the map, and then you create this 1-3-1, 1-4 split push setup, which SK won't have an answer for. So that's how Rogue can pretty much break open the game.
SK may be looking at their inventories right now, though, and saying, okay, Trinity Force on Sakurai, Trinity Force complete on Crown Shot, the Mirror Mana fully stacked up. It may be too little too late, but this is the point at which you say this is the strongest we're going to get relative to Rogue, probably. The further the game goes on... Oh, see? That's some damage.
That's your problem.
Yeah, but you kill everyone else laughing on one at a time.
I mean, fair. Alright, I will give you that. All Rogue needs to do is just not die everywhere else. But I love the fact that Inspired is also playing through Larson, making it even easier for him to generate pressure. Hansama and Fana are just acting as wave player, and he's just hovering him. Giving him that extra bit of support. If someone shows up, they go for the kill. Jax is acting as wave clear right now, which is the thing that's blocking Larson, because Jax can also invest his ultimate into stopping the Ryze from getting close to the tower. Larson's taking a lot of damage, he's probably going to base now.
SK could just force, as soon as they get inside, and Rumble coming up, Larson goes forward. I mean, SK could force Baron if they really wanted to.
I don't think they can.
I mean, okay. I'm not saying it's a good play. I'm saying it is a good play.
Usually when you say they could do this, it's usually because it makes sense.
Well, they could make play towards Finn, and Finn could just walk away.
So they're going to invest... Okay, so this is actually great timing for SK because Larson has just based, which means they should be able to get the tower for free. But of course, what the Dawson does is it guarantees rogue priority in, but they're not going to use it. They're going to look for a collapse instead. The Larson doesn't have ultimate, so you can't really close the gap yet. You need to go back to mid lane, because you're not going to get it at the top. You can invest into the river vision if you want to. But Drake is also spawning soon, so that might be your next primary objective.
If Rogue gets the dragon, then goes back to popcorn as well for the Cloud Soul.
Yep.
Not the most impactful, but it still does all the time.
I mean, it also spawns the Elder, which is the really impactful part. Having movement speed on Larson is also going to be useful in the side lane.
And also cooldown, bring those waves forward even quicker.
I'd say it's less useful, but yes. I mean, like, having stats is always useful. I just think that those stats... I think it's a top priority with this. It makes it a lot easier to see up to the base of their team. We talked about how Cloud not the most valuable for their comp, which means that just securing this objective will offer Rogue a lot more, and it can easily close out the game too.
Right, this is true there by Rogue. 24 minutes, and they're going to walk towards me, and go down towards that
Cloud. Yeah, they can also get the Drake on top of it. I like the fact that they did go for the Baron first. So when we get the replay up, we can see how this fight actually kicked off. So it's actually SK that wants to try and get this collapse off. They have the numbers advantage. Vanda acting as good disengage, but then the flank comes in from Finn. Doesn't even need to use his teleport. Everyone is separated away from Starkraiser, so he's the first to be shut down. And then Finn basically solo kills Strike on the backside. The TP from Jax is far too late. There's nothing that he can do to offer support to the rest of his team. And this is just a fight that SK thought they could win, but Finn is just too strong.
Trick deciding not to use ultimate all his flash in that fight, so Sakura didn't have the time to use the showstopper, so when you're not able to find those things, find those connections, very difficult for you to find. And Rogue are doing what Rogue have done, this split. Separate the map up, get Larson into a side lane on this ride. It's really pressure. And you can see there's already two players from SK trying to deal with that rise, who's level 16, has a Banshee now alongside the fully stacked Rod of Ages.
Probably the weakest of the rogue carry right now. This is the other thing about Braun. He's also really good at shutting down the wave from Victor as well. The shield completely mitigates his death rate, and it also mitigates the poke and damage measures also. That's kind of why I'm surprised to see those, or at least these rogue pick and draft, but Braun's going to have to see how good it is against Victor as well. And Rogue just playing through all three lanes right now, slowly but surely, breaking into the base of SK.
Wait for these next waves. Push in bot lane is where Larson is going to go. Being set up towards that top side, True Savage. Finds a whole lot of nothing in the mid lane. SK are trying to engage with Predator. Finn will realize all of SK are in the mid lane and can push in. Inspired and Larson off towards the top side. Tide goes down to about half HP. Larson can pop around more if they want. Need to finish there, pushing in. Zachary going to come over and try and answer this. Oh, good flash from Finn away from the base breaker, and now Rogue can push him in. Larson still has the wall of the fight, Crown Shot going forward, lands a mystic shot. Gets a moonshot in return, and see the damage coming out from Hansel with it. Comes out as well. Moonlight Vision's not going to be enough. Larson inside goes down, trick flashing forward, gets the knockback on the Larson. The damage is in there. No, he killed him as you say, that he is. Chaos Storm coming out, Larson almost falls. Unable to survive, and eventually he does go down. Jax is going to get chased in, and his hands are back to join the party. Fade off towards the top, comes in for a little bit of dessert on this delicious peak of a game. Double kill by Hansel, Crown Shot getting chased out by Finn on his signature Aatrox. And you have to do this in the game. 13 seconds left on Trick, the inhibitor's going to fall in this bottom lane. Crown Shot eats a moonshot, and just falls back. Even with the True Shot barrage, oh, great block dead by Vanda. The Nexus Towers, next on the menu here for Rogue, taking forward and trying to get up towards the top of the table. With a bit of a win, Vanda flashes forward, Crown Shot jumps away, The main trick that I'm hardly doing anything about this. Rogue will take the Nexus, and they will take down XA.
I think it ended up hurting them overall. We can see a bit of a replay, look back at some of the action that happened at the very end. Larson, of course, did die, but you can see that. We said it, Walcott took at least three people to kill him. I'd say that was three.
I agree with you there,
but Inspire doing a really good job as well with the arrival of Hansar and then Finn from the flank. It's pretty much just a clean up fight from the side of Rogue. It sucks to say, but SK basically didn't do anything this game. They just kind of slowly walked.